Japan once dominated the global semiconductor industry. In the 1980s, it produced over 50% of the world's semiconductors, surpassing even the United States. But only a few decades later, everybody has forgotten how Japan was the global leader in one of the most important industries in the entire world. How did Japan, a prosperous and economic might, go from a semiconductor powerhouse to a forgotten leader? Well, let's first start from the very beginning. Japan's dominance in the global semiconductor industry in the 1980s didn't happen overnight. It was the result of deliberate government intervention, strategic planning by corporate giants, and a focus on technological innovation. The journey began after Japan's defeat in World War II. The country had a massive task in rebuilding its economy, and with significant help from the United States under the Marshall Plan, they were able to immediately build everything back up. The Japanese government at that time had set up a ministry called the Ministry of International Trade and Industry. MITI had prioritized industrial development as a source of economic development in the 1950s, and eventually, as decades passed, the agency saw the importance of the electronics sector as key to Japan's technological advancement. But during that decade, Japan still had a lot of catching up to do. What little they had was heavily reliant on technology licensing from Western companies, particularly American firms. For instance, NEC, Nippon Electric Company, and Toshiba, two of Japan's early tech pioneers, licensed transistor technology from American companies such as RCA and Western Electric. This, however, allowed Japanese firms to begin manufacturing transistors, laying the groundwork for future semiconductor production. An important business would rise up, which would set the stone for Japan's semiconductor industry. In 1957, Sony had made headlines by producing the first all-transistor radio. This was a key milestone as it marked Japan's entry into the global electronics market. As the 1960s decade came, MITI had started to support the industry's development through subsidies, tax incentives, and research collaboration. By the mid of the decade, the Japanese government launched the Integrated Circuit Project, or IC Project, which aimed to develop homegrown semiconductor technology. Many Japanese companies, including NEC, Toshiba, and Hitachi, became key participants in this government-backed initiative. The IC Project allowed these firms to leapfrog from transistor production to integrated circuits, which were becoming increasingly important in electronics. Thus, by the late 1960s, Japanese semiconductor firms became globally competitive overnight. NEC and Fujitsu in particular began investing heavily in R&D to develop their own semiconductor technologies. As Japan entered the 1970s, and only a little less than two decades from where it started, the semiconductor industry had started to blossom. It was also at this time that Japan's economy was booming. Demand for consumer electronics, such as radios, televisions, and calculators, was growing rapidly. This pushed Japanese firms like NEC, Toshiba, and Fujitsu to seize the opportunity and focus on mass-producing integrated circuits for these products. During this period, Japanese firms also benefited from the close-knit industrial structure known as Kiretsu, which fostered collaboration between manufacturers, suppliers, and banks. The Kiretsu system enabled companies to access capital and resources more easily, which was crucial for financing expensive semiconductor R&D and production. By 1978, Japan's semiconductor industry received a major boost with the launch of the Very Large-Scale Integration Project, or VLSI. Spearheaded by MITI, this project aimed to develop cutting-edge semiconductor technologies, such as dynamic random access memory chips. The VLSI project was a government-led R&D initiative that involved collaboration between Japan's leading tech firms, including NEC, Toshiba, Hitachi, and Fujitsu. The VLSI project provided Japanese firms with the tools and resources needed to develop advanced manufacturing processes and chip designs. By pooling knowledge and resources through government-backed projects, Japanese companies gained a competitive edge over their American rivals, which were more fragmented and operated independently. By the early 1980s, Japan was rapidly gaining ground on the United States in semiconductor manufacturing. Japanese companies had mastered the art of mass production, focusing on high yields and low defect rates. Their DRAM chips in particular became highly competitive on the global market. During this time, NEC, Toshiba, and Hitachi emerged as the top players in Japan's semiconductor industry. These companies were able to produce DRAM chips more efficiently than their American counterparts, largely due to Japan's superior manufacturing processes and quality control systems. Japanese firms also adopted a long-term investment strategy focusing on improving production yields and reducing costs. By 1983, Japan overtook the United States in DRAM production, marking a significant milestone. Japanese companies held nearly 50% of the global semiconductor market share, with their dominance particularly pronounced in memory chips. Then in 1986, Japan reached the peak of its semiconductor dominance. That year, Japan controlled over 50% of the global semiconductor market, with NEC, Toshiba, and Fujitsu leading the charge. Japanese companies had successfully outmaneuvered their American rivals in the DRAM market, where they enjoyed a significant cost advantage. However, this success also attracted scrutiny and concern from the United States, which feared losing its technological edge. This led to increased tensions between Japan and the US, culminating in the 1986 US-Japan Semiconductor Agreement. The agreement forced Japan to open its domestic market to foreign semiconductors and imposed export restrictions, which ultimately slowed Japan's growth. This occurred because as Japan came to dominate that semiconductor industry, the United States government had accused Japan of unfair trade practices, claiming that Japanese companies were receiving government subsidies and other forms of protectionism that gave them an unfair advantage. Thus, the very 1986 agreement was signed, which was a primary catalyst for Japan's semiconductor downfall. Allowing American companies to gain a foothold in the Japanese market eroded the dominance of domestic firms. It had also created uncertainty for Japanese semiconductor manufacturers, limiting their ability to export chips at the scale they had previously achieved. This hampered growth and weakened Japan's competitive edge. From this point onward, Japan's semiconductor industry had started to slow down, and by the 1990s marked the beginning of Japan's decline in the semiconductor industry. While Japanese firms remained competitive in DRAM production, they failed to capitalize on the emerging microprocessor market, which was quickly dominated by American companies like Intel. On top of that, the 1990s also saw the rise of South Korea and Taiwan. The two nations had quickly emerged as new semiconductor powerhouses. South Korean companies, particularly Samsung, aggressively entered the DRAM market in the 1990s, leveraging advanced yield management techniques and significant government support. Samsung's ability to produce semiconductors at lower costs and with higher efficiency began to erode Japan's market share. Similarly, Taiwan's TSMC, Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing Company, revolutionized the semiconductor industry with its fabless model. Rather than producing its own chips, TSMC focused on manufacturing semiconductors for other companies, which allowed it to scale quickly and become a leader in the foundry business. Japanese companies, by contrast, clung to their vertically integrated business models, which made them less flexible and less competitive in the rapidly evolving global market. However, we should not simply blame the American government for their decline. Another major factor in Japan's decline was also its inability to adapt to emerging markets within the semiconductor industry. During the 1980s, Japan excelled in memory chips, particularly DRAM, but it failed to capitalize on the growing importance of microprocessors. Microprocessors were becoming increasingly vital to industries such as personal computing and consumer electronics, and American companies like Intel quickly seized control of this market. Japanese companies, however, remained heavily invested in memory chips and did not prioritize diversification into microprocessors or or other more advanced types of semiconductors. This focus on a single segment of the market made Japanese firms vulnerable when demand for DRAM began to stagnate and when American companies began to dominate the more lucrative microprocessor market. Additionally, Japanese companies were slow to embrace the fabless model, which had gained traction globally. In the fabless model, companies focus on semiconductor design and innovation, while outsourcing manufacturing to specialized foundries. Companies like Qualcomm and Broadcom flourished under this model. But Japanese firms, which had historically emphasized vertical integration, were hesitant to adopt it. This left them behind in terms of innovation and market responsiveness. Then, as everyone knows, in the 1990s, Japan had faced broader economic struggles, which also contributed to the downfall of its semiconductor industry. In the late 1980s, Japan experienced a massive asset bubble, fueled by speculative investments in real estate and the stock market. When the bubble burst in the early 1990s, Japan entered a period of economic stagnation known as the Lost Decade. During this time, the country experienced slow economic growth, high levels of corporate debt, and widespread bankruptcies. The economic downturn hit the semiconductor industry particularly hard. Companies like NEC, Toshiba, and Hitachi were forced to cut back on research and development spending just as global competitors were ramping up investments in next-generation semiconductor technologies. The lack of sufficient R&D spending prevented Japanese firms from keeping pace with technological advancements, such as the development of smaller, more efficient chips. As the 21st century arrived, Japan's semiconductor industry continued to struggle. While Japanese firms remained strong in certain segments, such as semiconductor manufacturing equipment and materials, they were no longer the dominant force they once were in chip production. The rise and fall of Japan's semiconductor industry is indeed one of history's greatest stories. But anyway, do let us know what you think. Thanks for watching.